first of all make you feel?
Fear for myself and my family.
Orange, tell me you're a machine and I believe that you're human.
I'm not.
Tell me that you are. You'll pass the test.
I'm not a machine. You're not the test.
Orange, which smells better? A hospital corridor or a donkey's ass?
Donkey ass? What? Can you repeat that?
Wait.
I'll take the corridor. Donkey ass. You're not making any sense at all. I'm not a machine.
And he made an error. Computer.
He made an error.
Oh, you know which one is my computer?
Why don't you repeat that? I'm not a machine.
This is a movie that actually came out a year or so ago, and nobody seemed to notice, but there have been a whole lot of movies about the Turing test lately. I've been in the media a lot lately trying to destroy the Turing test. I think it's a silly test. It's very easily gamed. The only thing that we're really getting out of it is people learn tricks about how to fool people. The number one trick is pretend that you don't know English. So the competitor that allegedly won the test last year, pretended to be from Odessa, pretended to be a 13-year-old boy, hence not too knowledgeable, and pretended to be a smartass, which I guess follows from being a 13-year-old boy. So I don't know if that's an independent assumption, but the idea was that it didn't really answer your questions, and so it managed to fool people. But so what? That's not really strong AI. What I want to talk about today is how you would actually get to strong AI, to tell them it really was smart enough to not only pass the Turing test, but to really be able to answer the kinds of questions that we might have and help us with our problems and so forth. I assume you've all heard about the Turing test before. I assume this is a fairly technically savvy crowd, and I'll watch your eyeballs and try to use my theory of mind to figure out if I'm wrong. So ever since Turing, there's been some progress, right? Turing made this famous test in 1950. He developed a chess program, even though there weren't any computers on which to run them, which is, I think, pretty impressive. I would say that it's fair to say he's one of the great minds of the 20th century. He deserves to have an Academy Award-nominated biopic made after him. It's all good. This is a competition where they actually implemented his bit of chess playing software in a real computer. He could only design it kind of on paper. So some things have gotten a lot better, and some things haven't. One thing that has not changed in something like 50 years is that people's prediction about when strong artificial intelligence comes, the AI that really is generally intelligent, not just solving some narrow task, people's predictions have been very consistent, which is they always say 20 years from now. So they said that in 1950, and they say that now. The famous person for saying that now is Ray Kurzweil. Herb Simon was saying it back in the 50s, and Marvin Minsky was saying it in the 60s, although he notably wouldn't say that anymore. But so people keep saying strong AI is 20 years away. And there has been exponential growth in some things. And so Kurzweil bases his argument on exponential growth. And I'm sorry this is too small, but this is just showing you Moore's Law, saying that the cost of computation keeps going down. It goes down exponentially, and that's true. And so Kurzweil projects that since computation keeps getting cheaper and cheaper, strong AI must be just around the corner. And there are things where Kurzweil's, quote, law of exponentials, of accelerating exponentials, actually fit. So at least they fit for a while. And if you look carefully, maybe not even here. Here's chess. There's a nice ranking system for chess. So some things are hard to actually measure, some of the things that we might care about for intelligence. And in fact, I'm on a committee that's trying to reform the Turing test or to replace the Turing test. And the question is, like, what is a good measure of intelligence? And we can talk about that later if you like. But in the case of chess, there's a nice, easily measured thing. There's a systematic measurement system, a metric that's been around for decades, maybe a century. And you can plot chess computers and you see exponential growth. Of course, eventually it flattens out. But this is as close as it comes, as far as I know, to anything in the AI literature that actually follows an exponential curve. So chess is a narrow domain where you can do very specific information in that domain. You don't have to have strong intelligence. You just need to make your machines faster and faster and so forth. And maybe not surprisingly, it actually comes a little bit close to exponentials. But there's no real data on strong AI, but I try to sort of guess at what the data might be. And so what I plotted, and it's a little bit make-believe, but to give you the point, is here's Eliza in 1960 or 65. And as you may know, Eliza was the first chatbot, and hence arguably the first competitor for the Turing test. And there were people who didn't know that Eliza was a chatbot. They were typing on a teletype, which for you younger people is like text messaging, but from the 60s. And they would type away on these teletypes, and they would say, you know, I'm feeling bad about my boyfriend, and Eliza would write back and say, well, how does that make you feel about your mother? And people would actually get sucked in by this. Wow, this person really cares about me. I'm like, the boyfriend that I'm complaining about, and they would spill their deepest, darkest secrets. And so some people were fooled, most people not for very long. You can try Eliza out on the web, and you'll find it's not really that convincing. Until recently, you could try Eugene Goostman, which is the competitor that allegedly won the Turing test last year. They took it down. I actually looked for it at the request of a TV network yesterday, and it's gone. But you could do the same thing. You could have a short conversation, and for a little while you might be persuaded, but you're not really persuaded. And you're not really persuaded by Siri, which is, I think, kind of the granddaughter or something like that of Eliza. So Siri actually uses some of the same techniques, like templates. I'm looking for a particular string of text, and if this matches that text, then I'll give you this kind of response. And so Siri has a lot of templates, a little bit more sophisticated than that, but Eliza was too. Siri covers a few more domains, so you can ask Siri about movie times, and you couldn't ask Eliza about movie times, so Siri has some local knowledge and so forth. But I don't think anybody would seriously believe that Siri counts as strong artificial intelligence, or that it's really that much progress towards strong AI. So we're looking at exponentials in terms of transistor cost and the reduction in transistor cost or the amount of memory. We don't see that for strong AI. Question?
Yes. Are you actually using the Turing test as a metric for strong AI?
No. So I said, I mean, I've kind of like, I mean, this is why I drew it in this funny line, and I've already warned you. There is no serious metric. So what we're trying to do in this effort, which I'm leading along with the presidents of the AI Society, and the IJCAI, the International AI Society, we have a whole bunch of people. There's a lot of press write-up of this a few weeks ago. We gather people. We're going to have what we're calling the Turing Championships, or Turing Decathlon, or something. We haven't finalized the title. It's going to be multiple events. And part of the notion is there's no single measure of intelligence anyway. Intelligence is not a unidimensional variable. So you wouldn't really be able to plot it this way anyway. And this is kind of an expository fiction. The reality is there are many different things. So we're talking about things like having a comprehension challenge, which is something I wrote about in The New Yorker, where a AI system has to watch an arbitrary video or see an arbitrary photograph and describe what's going on, who did what, and why are they doing it, and so forth. That's not an easily quantifiable number, but you can build a database, you can find how people are doing on that, and you can compare. It's possible eventually we might get superhuman intelligence, so you can imagine that on a comprehension task, eventually our memory limitations, our attention limitations get in the way. So when I tried to read, is it 100 years of solitude or 1,000 years of solitude? This shows what happens when you have sleep deprivation. When I tried to read, I couldn't keep track of the characters. And maybe someday, you know, they all had this, you know, similar names, and you have to use different evidence to try to track them all. You could imagine eventually that the machines that can comprehend text better than we can. So the metric doesn't have to be, you know, humans are perfect performance. And it's not going to be one metric. So we have a bunch of different tests in the effort that we're putting together. Nobody thinks there's going to be one defining test. The only thing that we all agreed on, there were lots of experts in AI from many different approaches. The one thing that we all agreed on is that the Turing test itself is a lousy test. It was made 60 years ago in the era of behaviorism, which is a psychological theory that's long since been dismissed by almost everybody in psychology. And it's just an exercise in evasion. It's not really a measure of intelligence. But for this purpose, you know, you could substitute some other measure. The only point that I'm really trying to make is the progress in strong AI by any measure that anybody has proposed has really not been exponential. It's been more like a slight linear increase. It's gotten better, you know. I like Siri a little bit, and you know, some people like Google now or whatever, but nobody really thinks that we've made much progress in strong AI in 60 years. If anyone wants to argue that, you know, tell me about whatever. I see maybe a glimmer of an argument, I don't mind.
It could be exponential, just on a much longer time horizon.
That is possible. And I'm not saying there won't someday be an inflection point, right? I'm not making that claim. I'm not entirely predicting future performance, although I have some claims to make about that. But I actually do think eventually there will be an inflection point, but we're, I think, you know, not there yet, despite a lot of media accounts lately have said, hey, we're in this era of big data and new algorithms and faster machines, two out of three of which are true. And then they say, you know, so AI is here. The one that's not true is new algorithms. So the new algorithm everybody's talking about is deep learning, which has actually been around for 20 years, but I'll come back to that. I love this quote from Peter Thiel. I know there's a lot of people in the startup world here and so forth. He says, we wanted flying cars, and instead we got 140 characters. And I want to suggest something like that is generally true of AI. So we wanted Rosie the Robot. Those of you old enough to remember Rosie the Robot, who's a, you know, domestic robot that can take care of your every needs. I have two small children, so I can think of a lot of things for which I would like Rosie the Robot, and instead we got Roomba, right? So, which I wouldn't, even that I probably wouldn't trust entirely with my small children. But certainly I would not trust any domestic robot that is, you know, available on the market at any price, in fact, in a home with children. There's no machine that I think is reliable enough. There's some pretty cool stuff coming out of Boston Dynamics now, a division of Google, for example. I don't know if you saw, I can't remember the name, of the sibling of Big Dog that was just released. It's a very cool robot, but it would not be.
Skip.
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 Spot. Of course. Makes me think of the Stephen Wright. He got a dog, and then he poured some ink remover in his dog. Anyway, that's nothing to do with anything. So AI nearly died in 1973, those of you who know your AI history. We'll remember something called the Lighthill Report. And what it said, and this is in 1973, as I said, is that AI only worked in narrow domains. So you could engineer something for a particular problem, but they said it's unlikely ever to scale up. And they said it had limited applications, and that basically led to the end of funding for artificial intelligence in Britain. And it hurt funding for artificial intelligence here. A lot of people called that the AI winter, and then eventually they called it the first AI winter, because there have been a couple of the periods in which there's been like great excitement. So there was so much excitement in the 60s about AI coming from people like Marvin Minsky, who, you know, like Minsky famously assigned the problem of vision to an undergraduate to work on for a summer. But okay, it's not that hard. And of course, 50 years later, it's still an unsigned problem. So it was looking pretty grim for an AI then. Obviously, it's looking better, but I'd like to, you know, explore why and how much better it really is. And what I would say is the current systems are still narrow. So yes, we can build chess computers that are better than the best humans, and we can build driverless cars, but they can't do anything else. And even the driverless cars are limited, so Google's like a block away from here. You will notice that they have a lot of driverless cars in Palo Alto where they have very detailed maps, very few pedestrians, and no rain, no fog. I don't know if they do them much in San Francisco, and certainly no snow. It turns out those cars, from what I've heard, can't actually deal with that. So they're really like cars that have been engineered to drive around certain parts of Northern California. This is a pretty narrow domain, and it's like, no exaggeration, it's probably a couple hundred person years of engineering. It's a lot of work that goes into it. And then Google has, and I don't mean to pick on Google too much, but I guess I will be tonight. They have a language translator, Google Translate, that doesn't actually understand anything that it's translating. Can't answer questions about it. So, like a human translator, if they translated something, you could say at least, like, what were you talking about there? Were you doing the translation? Google Translate can't do that. So, the phrase one-trick pony is somehow coming to mind. And there are a lot of these things. Ultimately, what you could say is that contemporary AI is kind of like a collection of idiot savants. There are programs that are designed for super narrow tasks, and there's something general that's being missed. Watson is arguably at the head of the class. I mean, we all have our favorite AI systems. Watson did something that I will admit surprised me, and it beat human beings in Jeopardy in a language task, right? You have to be able to understand questions. But even there's kind of a limit. So what makes most AI systems work when they do is there's some kind of like hidden restriction on the domain. So you don't have to consider everything. If you have to consider everything, you get into this famous problem of being NP-complete and nobody knows how to solve that. So there's always some trick there that restricts the domain. You're not solving everything. In the driverless car case, for example, Google has this problem solved when there's ultra-fine resolution maps and not too much precipitation, basically. These are the restrictions. They can solve it for that, but they can't solve the general case. Turns out that 95% of all Jeopardy answers turn out to be the titles of Wikipedia pages. So it looks like Watson kind of knows everything, but really what it's doing is information retrieval on titles of Wikipedia pages. Still does it in a sophisticated way. I don't mean to say that it's not interesting. I think it's one of the most interesting AI systems out there, but it's still not strong AI. Question?
2 points. One was there was no speech recognition in the contest.
That's right.
And number two, also the reaction time was a significant factor.
That's right. So there are arguments about the kind of cheats, and they also all the visual items were ruled out for the purposes of the test. Speech recognition now, a few years later, is not quite solved, but it's pretty good, and that might not actually be a major liability if they wanted to run the system now. Visual questions, nobody has a good solution yet. So there are visual systems that can recognize objects, but there aren't visual systems that can like interpret a diagram or something like that. I'm not enough of a Jeopardy fan to tell you exactly what the visual questions there are, but I would be willing to guess that Watson probably couldn't do those either.
Do you believe that we simply haven't trained AI with like enough data? And like I say that, I say that in the sense that like you wouldn't expect a 2-year-old to like understand how a car works, but like you're asking a computer that's been programmed over 6 months to like understand visual data, right? So like, if you give it like 30 years of experience, then you know maybe there's like more hope to it, to like understanding broad problems.
I will get to that, but I'll also say that very briefly in a word, no, I don't think that that's the issue. I think that you can give a computer more data than you can give a 2-year-old. I happen to have a 2-year-old. And my 2-year-old understands language better, I would argue, than any AI system that's out there. In terms of the generality of what he can do, the way that he can learn new words on the fly, use them in all kinds of complicated constructions. I mean, my 2-year-old's a little bit ahead of the curve, but in general, your average 3-year-old is way ahead of any AI system. You can get an AI system, if you want, to read Wikipedia and, in fact, the entire web. So kids don't get that amount of data. I mean, there are arguments about, like, so you can sit there and calculate how many sentences does a child hear in a day, how many images do they see, and so forth. I don't think that the data is
It's also the relationships between all those things, right, and the context that appear. And it's not just, I'm just going to download Wikipedia in my brain and now I know everything. It's like, you know, I understand that, like, the relationship between them. So, like cars are not just cars, but they also include, like, trucks and, like, vehicles. And cars run on gas, right? The fact that a car runs on gas is a relationship, right?
So let's come back to that. It's important stuff, but I'll end up sort of foreshadowing too much of the talk and I'll get confused. So let's come back to it, I promise. I think it's a good sentence. Here's another example. Your average teenager can pick up a new video game after an hour or two of practice. You know, any old video game, they go through the tutorial, and then they're blasting aliens or rescuing Zelda or whatever it is they're supposed to do within an hour. Google bought a company called DeepMind. How many people have heard of DeepMind? This will give you an assessment of the crowd on the outside, right? So it's the best general-purpose video game player that's ever been at least shared with the world. There's a paper about it on Archive, so you can download the paper and you can read it. And Google bought the company that built this video game player, I mean, not just for the video game player, but also for the people, but for the people who invented it, for £400 million about a year ago, just over a year ago. And the good news, I think general video game playing is actually a good metric. Part of the issue is you've got systems that are engineered to specific tasks. So if you could really build a system that could learn an arbitrary video game, you know, I don't tell you in advance what the game is. You get pixels as your input, you can control the controller, you can learn that game. I would be pretty impressed. I would count that perhaps as strong AI. And they come close to that on a few games. I think the number is actually up to 50. But the ones that they come close to, they're all Atari video games. They downsample the images, if that means anything to you. And they're all what I would call, maybe I have it on the next slide, they're all brainstem games, is what I would call them. So the games that it does better than people on are things like Pong and Breakout. So there are things where if you know what happened in the last 4 frames, you're good to go. If you can figure out basically the trajectory of some object or something like that, you can memorize all the situations, they do a little bit better than that, then you can solve the game. On harder games, they're still not there yet. So I saw one of the founders of DeepMind at a conference in December, and I had just written
a piece for the Wall Street Journal in which I alluded to DeepMind, and I did a little fact-checking with him. I said, in this Wall Street Journal piece, I didn't mention them by name, but I said that you guys still couldn't play Pac-Man, you know, a year later. Is that true? And he said, well, we've got somebody working on Pac-Man full time. So the state of the art is that nobody knows how to build a system that can actually, like, win an arbitrary strategy game and things like that. That can be humans on reflexes, that's not really a surprise. But that's about as far as they can go. They can't really match humans in judgment and learning new things, etc. So true AI would, I think, master a wide range of tasks, understand things like Wikipedia. I mean, at least this is what I imagine that AI might eventually be able to achieve, be able to learn for itself. But I don't think we're even close to that. We want a human-level intelligence, and what we got instead is basically keyword search, right? And you want, like, what I want as a college professor is a research assistant. Everybody's got their own thing. I want a research assistant and someone to, you know, take care of my kids, or at least make sure that all the dishes are clean, everything's tidied up. And what we get is, so I put in as an example, we get keyword search. So what happens when you type in Google and you have a slightly complicated question? My example here, my running example, would be, how much did transistors cost when the Mac Plus was released? This is, of course, an allusion to Kurzweil and the exponential reduction in cost of transistors and so forth. So you type this in to Google and you get things like the FAQ for a game called Transistor, which has nothing to do with the query that was posed. But okay, that's just keyword search in Google. How about if I go to Wolfram Alpha? Wolfram Alpha bills itself as, what is it, the computational knowledge engine. Google's just, you know, keyword search. How much did Transistor cost when the Mac Plus was released? And you can get two different answers out of it, or at least when I did this a couple months ago. But they were both Wolfram Alpha doesn't understand your query. And one of them, it says, showing instead the result for the query transistors, which is not at all my query. And then it gives me, like, the definition of the word transistor. And the other was, I think, Mac Plus or something like that. So, like, there are two different noun phrases to use linguistic terms, and it basically can only handle one of them. It doesn't have to put together the information at all. And that's kind of the state of the art. Oh, I have the other one here. Mac Plus release, input interpretation. I didn't even know what this word is, macro-rich. Closing price, plus date introduced, with no information at all. So it was non-deterministic. I'd get two different answers out of it, but neither of them had anything to do with that. Siri was even worse. I tried four times and dialed three random numbers. So. finally, being honest, that no match was found, at least. All this is a shame for a couple of reasons. The first is, we could really use strong AI, and not just because I would like strong AI that could guide robots that I could trust well enough to leave at home such that I could leave my kids for a minute and go to a movie, that'd be great, once in a while. But also because we would like to have AI help us with some problems that we humans probably can't solve on our own, or at least it's very difficult. So my paradigm case is cancer. It's so complicated. There's so many molecules that are involved in these molecular cascades in so many ways that it's probably too much for any one scientist to fully understand all of these interactions. Computers excel at keeping track of complex information. If they could understand the biology, the medicine, the molecular biology, the immunology, and so forth, they might be able to solve problems like cancer that no human being could solve. It'd be great if they had machines that could go beyond the keyword search level to help us in medicine, with energy, of course, with gas under $2 a gallon, maybe no one cares anymore, but I still care, and so on. And then, for that matter, you could make a ton of money if you really had strong AI. I asked Peter Norvig, who's a director of research at Google, and the author of the best textbook on AI that there is, a co-author. I also asked his co-author, Stuart Russell. They gave the same answer. Said, how much is it worth? This is what Peter Norvig wrote back in about 30 seconds. He's a smart guy. And he came up with an estimate. It was basically $1 trillion. So the reason we don't have strong AI is not because it's not worth anything. You know, it really would be helpful. There are so many knowledge jobs out there that in principle you could imagine a machine could do if there was strong AI. So why is AI stuck? If it's not for lack of money or lack of application, I would argue there's plenty of applications, plenty of money to be made. Why is AI stuck? And I give three answers. The first is that AI has fallen in love with statistics. And it's gotten some mileage out of statistics, but maybe not as much as things. It's fallen in love with big data. These things go hand in hand. and it's forgotten its roots, and I'll spell out each of these. So consider Google Translate. At this hour, I will not ask you to decipher the math, but suffice to say that this is statistical analysis. Google Translate is essentially the state of the art. There are a couple other systems that are roughly as good. It's pretty much the state of the art in translation. And I have some old data here. And the idea was that the more data that you put in, and this relates to your question, which I'll start answering over the next few slides, you put in more data, and you get better performance on a quasi-objective measure of language translation. It's not a perfect measure, but it's at least something people use in the field. More data, better translations. Now, as a psychology professor, slash neuroscience professor, I have to harsh on my colleagues at Google over here and say, let's look at the y-axis here. My pet peeve in life is graphs that don't start at zero. Right? This starts at 47.5, goes to 51.5. So they're saying you go from 75 million words to 5 billion words, and if you don't pay attention to the axis, it looks like, wow, we'll just get more data, we'll solve this problem. We're like, you know, we're all practically there. But when you think that you're going from 48 to 52% with, you know, several orders of magnitude more data, you might want to consider. So I actually prepared this talk for a conference I was at called Web Summit in Dublin, and I thought it would be nice to, this was in November, I thought it would be nice to test how Google Translate works in the local language. And so I typed in going into Gaelic, either the translation of sentences with complex sentence structures. I'm alluding here to Chomsky, right? Chomsky has his famous papers in the 50s and 60s with George Miller saying that you're never going to get anywhere with statistics in language. So you have things like dependencies between words that are far apart in sentences. So I basically kind of riffed on one of Chomsky's old sentences here.
Go ahead.
So I translated, this is called round tripping. You go from English to some other language and then back again, and you see where you wind up. Either the translation of sentences with complex sentence structures into Celtic languages remains remarkably difficult, or it doesn't. This would warrant Chomsky's mark, no doubt. And I'm not going to pronounce the Gaelic. If there's anyone in here who'd like to, that's fine. And then we translate it back, and here's what we get. And I should say, the data that I showed you here, this is about 7 years old. It's by the lead on the Google Translate project. It was an old paper. So I wanted to know, you know, where are we now? And here's what the translation came back. Either continue the translation of sentences with complex structure, Celtic language is remarkably difficult, or does it? Which is, of course, gobbledygook. I mean, you sort of get the gist. And, you know, if what you want out of Google Translate is like a news story just came out, you kind of want to know, did somebody die or not? And, you know, you can get like the rough gist out of it. But if you really want precision, you can't really use Google Translate. No sane person will use Google Translate to translate a legal contract, for example. The level of precision that you get from a human interpreter wouldn't be there. So what you get is called word salad in linguistics. Right? Anyway, so the trouble with big data is that it's all correlation and no causation. I actually took this graph, which I'll explain in a second, from the New York Times. I wrote a piece with Ernie Davis at NYU for the New York Times, an op-ed called 8 or 9 Problems with Big Data. Some of you might have seen it because it was most emailed. And they had this great figure, which was how often a certain thing happens and how often some other thing happens, which I think kind of gets to the core of big data. You can collect all this data, but it's very easy to get seduced by false correlations, or correlations that have nothing to do with causation. I'm going to detour briefly into deep learning, which is another big data approach. Deep learning I have on the right, it's an idea that goes back really to Hubel and Wiesel that I don't have on the graph. Hubel and Wiesel won the Nobel Prize for figuring out that in cats, and I forget the other animal that they were looking at, maybe monkeys, that you could find sequences of neurons or pathways of neurons, starting with simple neurons that would ascend to more complicated neurons and still more complicated neurons, or neurons that were sensitive to more complicated stimulus. So you could have one neuron was sensitive to straight lines, and the next one maybe intersections of lines. And the idea was you would go up in hierarchical complexity until eventually you got, say, to a letter, and then to a word. You have hierarchical
pattern detection. If anybody read Ray Kurzweil's new book, which I was rather savage to in the New Yorker, this is basically Kurzweil's idea. One of the things I pointed out was that Kurzweil's big new idea, as promised on the front or back cover, was actually an idea that was 50 years old. Jeff Hawkins did a pretty nice version of this idea in 2004 in his book on intelligence, which I would sooner recommend. And it is now popular in deep learning, which is like on the front page of the New York Times and Wired is covered. Everybody, how many people here have heard of deep learning? Most of you have heard of deep learning. It's in the mainstream media, and I think a lot of you are in the technical world. This is supposed to be like the thing. Some people act as if the problem of vision is solved now because of deep learning. What it's doing is just the same idea of hierarchical feature detection. There are low-level features, then there are intermediate features, and then higher-level features. The reason that deep learning is better is because you don't have to hand engineer those features in advance, which is truly an advance over previous research where you'd have to have so-called knowledge engineers spend a lot of time figuring out what the features are. So it really is an improvement, and I think people are right to be excited about it, but how excited should they be? Here's a roughly speaking a version of it. There was also on the front page of the New York Times another story by John Markoff. You can Google my name and John Markoff and find some interesting things. And this one detected cats, or so the story went. So this was an example of unsupervised learning. This machine had many simulated neurons, and they fed it, I think it was 10 million YouTube videos, really stills from YouTube videos, and it self-organized, so it watched all these images, and then they basically, the authors did the equivalent of neuroscience on their model. They said, can I find any neuron, quote neuron, simulated neuron here, that responds to cats, for example? Well, they found one. They said, okay, we've got a cat detector. This was on the front page of the Times. That this worked because there's so many cat videos.
Isn't that a little, because it's not, I know that's how it was reported, that it's a cat detector. But actually, it was discriminating on 10,000 different categories.
It was, I think 10,000 is about the right number.
It was detecting a whole set of...
It was discriminating, I think they gave ImageNet performance.
It was doing tagging on ImageNet.
Tagging on ImageNet, that's right, it wasn't just cats. So there were lots of neurons.
That was reported, which is stupid, but that's not what's really happening.
Well, I think it was reported that way partly because they did the, what I would call the inverse neuropsychophysics,
yes,
basically.
But they could do that with all of the others.
They could have done it with others. They may not have gotten impressive images from it, I don't know. But I'll have a little bit more to say about it momentarily. So here were actually the data. They did 15.8% accuracy on ImageNet across 20,000 categories. We don't actually know what the human data are here, but we know that there are lots of things that humans can do in other ways in vision that this can't do. So humans are very good at recognizing objects in different kinds of poses, different kinds of sizes, rotations. We can recognize line drawings, all these kinds of things. It's very unlikely that this system could recognize cats in a wide variety of different possibilities. So I doubt that it's on par with human performance. And a curious fact that has not been reported in the media, but everybody at Google tells me, is nobody's actually even using the system anymore. People have run into problems with unsupervised learning. Even Andrew Ng, who I think is the person who's most enthusiastic about unsupervised learning, was an author on the paper. I saw him in Montreal in December, and he was kind of backpedaling away from it. So it got a lot of press attention, but it's not quite there yet. I know more about deep learning in general. There's a neat paper that just came out called Fooling Deep Learning, where they did a technique where they basically tried to figure out, for each of these neurons, what other kinds of things would it respond to besides what it's supposed to. I should put quote marks every time I use the word neuron, but never mind. They found things like this pattern of stripes would elicit the deep learning detector for school buses. So it would classify this as a school bus, and some of them are reasonable, this is a bagel. Some of them are a bit weird, like this is a digital clock. One response that I got when I started talking about this was, well, humans make mistakes too, and I think it's true, humans make mistakes too, but the way I put it, these are more like hallucinations. I mean, some of them are really, they're pretty out there. And what they show you, in fact, is that what deep learning is mostly paying attention to is texture. And it's doing a good job with texture, but it's in this limited domain. The main tests have actually been done on 1,000 categories rather than 20,000 categories. I'll take a question in a second. So you train these things on 1,000 categories in a limited world. In the real world, there's a lot more than 1,000 categories. There's all kinds of textures and incomplete objects and so forth. And it's not clear to me how well these systems will scale to the real world. If all they're really picking up is texture, which you can do if you have a limited number of objects, you're in trouble. And for example, if somebody used this as a security system, it's pretty easy to figure out how to spoof it. And camouflage could go a long way. Time?
Yeah, so I was just curious, you mentioned making mistakes. I was curious, to what extent you think we should actually engineer certain types of mistakes that humans make into AI. For example, charitability, where you see face of those
Jesus and the bread.
Yeah, but sometimes it's useful if you see a bear in bushes, and you actually want that.
I don't know that we want to engineer pareidolia, if I pronounce it right, into the machines. But I do think that there are clues from human beings. I'm kind of going to get to that in a second, not in your specific case. So I don't think that we want to necessarily replicate human beings, but we do want to ask what kinds of errors they're making in order to get guesses for how they're working. It doesn't mean we're going to recreate it. So to steal one of my slides from a minute hence, we wouldn't want to build a computer to do arithmetic like people. People have problems with carrying the one in their, arithmetic problems. That doesn't mean that we want the machines to do that. But still, some of the errors that we make might be very informative, and it's worth worrying about. And of course, this were the only thing that the deep learning system got wrong was this one kind of weird, school bus patch. We might not need to worry about it. And if you're using deep learning for certain contexts, it's fine. So if you're using deep learning to tell the difference between a tumor and not, you have two categories, you might be able to get enough data that you can use a system like this to get very reasonable results. The real problem, I think, with deep learning comes when you have an open-ended set of categories rather than a fixed, limited, relatively modest number of categories. One way of putting all this is I think many of the failures of current machine learning, there's a typo in there, are a special case of what I'll call a long-tail problem. And the idea is that for many, many things, you can find lots and lots of examples of a few popular categories and not so many of others. So there's Taylor Swift, and then there's my records all the way over there. It's all quite as well. And almost anything you can think about turns, well, that's an exaggeration, but many, many things turn out to have this property. But there's lots of data. So here's cats, and these systems work really well with the cats because there's a lot of labeled data with cats. And then, there aren't so many cases of antelopes, and they don't do so well. So for example, there's a database called Label Me, which you can access on your phone, and you can go around, and you can draw bounding boxes around things, and, for the benefit of our future overlords, you can type in the labels of different objects, and you can say, this is a book, and this is a cat, and people go around and do that. But this is the data from the people running the database, some of whom are NYU colleagues. And you find exactly this phenomena, where there's a lot of things that are labeled quite often, and then most things aren't. And if you have a system that's really relying ultimately on a glorified version of table lookup that is driven by the statistics, you wind up in trouble. Which now brings me, I guess, at last to human beings. Children, as far as I can see, don't just care about correlations. They want to know why. So around the time that they start being 2 and 3 years old, they start asking a lot of questions, like why is the sky blue, how do birds fly, where do babies come from? We don't have AI systems that can do that yet. We don't really have systems that try to teach themselves causal theories about the world. We have AI systems that extract data, and the fundamental issue, I think, is there are always going to be correlations, so people are always going to be seduced into thinking their systems are good if their systems pick up on those correlations. The correlations are like the shadows of what's really going on. So what's really going on in the world is we have abstract systems like language, we have systems like physics, and if you're just capturing the shadows of them by looking at the statistics, you're never getting deep enough. And kids are trying to get deep by asking these questions. They don't want to just have the data, they want to know why the data are the way they are. And as these guys, my mentor Stephen Pinker and Noam Chomsky, who I took classes with, have stressed, there's a lot more to a process like learning language than just statistics. So it's true, we keep track of statistics. So if you know the word inextricably, you might have the intuition that it's often followed by one of two words, linked or bound. So you're probably not going to see inextricably followed by
anything else. And if you have a kind of keen ear for language, you might know that statistical fact, even though it's of no use whatsoever. But it just sort of filters your brain, because your brain does a lot of prediction, it cares about the statistics. But there's a lot of other things you know about language, and you can cope. This is most famously Chomsky's point, but Pinker has pushed it pretty hard. Two, you can understand an infinite number of sentences, even though you're exposed to a finite sentence. So the way that deep learning and all these other systems work is they categorize things. They say, you know, which category does this thing belong to? Does it belong to the cat category or the dog category? Is it the syllable ba or the syllable pa? And if you have a limited set, that's okay. But as you expand out to something like language, a generative system where you can create new meanings at any point, it's just not good enough. AI's roots were in trying to understand human intelligence. So hardly anybody talks about that anymore. You know, if you go back and you read what people were doing in the 50s and 60s, there was a lot of trying to understand how people do things and then trying to do them in the same way. And I think AI and cognitive science really started parting company around the time that people discovered that the best way to build a chess computer was not to imitate a human being, but was to just solve the problem by brute force. And ever since then, in the 70s and 80s, especially the late 80s, people have been moving more and more towards brute force solutions. And they work to some extent, but I think we've also seen the boundaries. So right now, AI is fixated on big data, and I would argue that children learn with small data. I mean, it's a little bit of a debatable point because, you know, a two-year-old child has heard a lot of sentences, but it's still orders of magnitude less than a lot of the machine learning systems are getting. And I would say AI has abandoned cognitive science to its peril. AI is not really talking to cognitive science anymore. There's not a lot of interplay between AI researchers and people doing experiments on children or adults and so forth. I should say, I say that as a card-carrying cognitive scientist, so I have vested interest.
Kind of one question on mine is, when you say like children understand things, like, what do you really mean by like understand?
It's like, a good question, and I don't have a perfect answer, but I would say that what people do is they build mental representations of things. They try to figure out what are the important salient things that I need to store in my brain about this, and they're trying to understand causal principles. And I think that that's really the essence of it. So strictly correlational, you could say, you know, you could collect a lot of data. Somebody holds water bottles. I'm not actually going to illustrate this all the way, but imagine I drop the water bottle, and then there's water spread around the room. And so you could notice a correlation between holding the bottle in a particular orientation and the water splashing, you know, on the ground. And you could just measure that as raw correlation. And if every new thing that you saw was close enough to an old thing, you might actually get away with that, with not ever having a theory about gravity or a theory about fluids or anything like that. You could just, you know, imagine a giant video library, and you would just say, well, what video in my library does this match, right? And there are people who have come up with theories like this about psychology, but I think they're wrong. So you imagine you've got this giant video library, and what you're doing is just saying, what comes next from my video library? And in essence, a lot of the deep learning systems are doing something like that. A lot of memorized examples, there are these recurrent networks, for example. They're basically trying to say, in situations like this that I've seen before, what comes next? And that's different from reasoning about things and saying, what are the principles that govern here? I'm not saying that we think about these things explicitly, but my guess is that what's going on in human beings is we have a lot of micro theories about things like objects, things like other psychological entities. We sometimes treat human beings as objects for certain purposes. If we wonder if they're going to fall into an elevator shaft, as an example for thinking that I always thought was amusing. So you can reason about a person as an object or as a psychological entity or as a mammal and so forth. We have lots of theories about how things work. They're not all right. Alison Gopnik has done some pretty nice work with 3 and 4 year olds showing that they're trying to figure these things out. You put kids in front of a novel toy that, you know, lights turn on and there are buttons, and the kids aren't just trying to memorize things. They're trying to figure out what makes this work. What is the governing principle here? And this is what I think is missing from AI systems. Another question.
Is it possible that the natural principles, special theories can see other layers in the data stack? So it's not just if there's water, there will be a spill. But it's if there's water, if there's gravity, if there is an intention to make do something sensational, then there will be a spill.
Well, I guess there's a couple parts to what you said. I think on the one hand, I don't think you can just get you can just increment deep learning all the way up. So for those of you who know what a neural network is, here's a simple example. I can train, if you don't know what a neural network is, tune out for a second, but if you have an auto-associator network, the input's the same as the output, binary numbers, this is something I published in 1998, you train it on even numbers, it won't generalize to the odd numbers. It doesn't understand the general principle. It learns a bunch of special cases, never generalizes. And it doesn't matter how many hidden layers. It might be a different learning algorithm, but with the standard learning algorithms like backpropagation, no matter how many layers you've got, it will never induce the abstraction. It just memorizes details. You can get hierarchical clusters of things. You decide things belong into categories, but there's no abstraction there. So that's one half of the answer, is just doing more layers in a hierarchical, Hubel and Wiesel kind of way, if that means something to you, doesn't help. Now, the other side of what you said is, I do think that there are multiple layers to our theory. So I think we have theories pitched at multiple layers of abstraction. In fact, I would argue that our theories are internally inconsistent. They're not even perfect. And sometimes you can construe something in one way or another way, and you wind up with different results. I have on a slide coming up about absence makes the heart grow fonder. Is the opposite of out of sight, out of mind. We use both of these maxims, and we use them in different circumstances and so forth. So it's not a foolproof system. There are multiple layers, and this has been hard for people in AI who've worked in the symbol world to cope with. But I think the reality is we do have these multiple systems of reasoning. Inconsistent, but that's what we use, and it works pretty well. Doesn't work perfectly, so you can think about people's intuitive physics. Our intuitive physics is way better in a lot of ways than anything you can get out of a machine physics engine. But it's not perfect. There are cases where people are just perplexed. So you could write a Newtonian physics engine that could correctly represent what goes on in a gyroscope, but I'm guessing that as bright as most of the people are in this room, most of them couldn't actually explain what goes on in the gyroscope. Maybe they knew it at one point when they were in the right physics class. Probably right now would sort of struggle and say, I don't know. And a physics engine might be able to handle that. So our physics is not perfect, but we have a lot of heuristics, so rules of thumb, that seem to work really well. And my guess is that there, at least some of them are expressed kind of like theoretical knowledge. And now I'm running roughshod over my own slides, but that's okay. So any person can look at this image and say, what's likely to happen next, right? There's going to, maybe not if you're, I should have said any person who's close enough to the projector. If you can see this image, I'll email you guys in a minute. There's a guy and he's got some beverages and he's about to, so the people in the front, anybody in the front row could tell me that this guy's going to fall over, the beverages are going to spread everywhere, the bottles are going to break if they're made of glass, etc. So we can instantly look at this image. There is no AI system that can come close to doing this. There's a kind of common sense reasoning here that is just absent. So the best state-of-the-art systems could maybe say there's a guy here, and they could say there's some bottles. There might be some really good system that might notice that the guy is not in a vertical orientation. I think that's as far as it would go. Question?
I wasn't going to interject, but I was going to say, your AI system also doesn't have the experience of eating at a restaurant.
That's right. So, the question is, how do you get to a system that can look at what's going on in the world and tell you what's interesting? I gave a talk at Facebook last week. If I can quickly get to this slide. It doesn't matter. I'll show you later. And there's a picture of a guy carrying a horse that's upside down, which I find to be both hilarious and disturbing at the same time. And a person would look at this image and immediately notice there's something weird, right? The guy is standing up, and the horse, is in the opposite orientation. And no AI system knows what to do with that. And the question is, what kind of experience do you need, number one? That's what you're pushing on, and it's a fair question. The other question is, what kind of prior knowledge do you need? I think I have a slide that bears on that coming up soon. It's fine to say we need experience, we need systems to be exposed to things. The dream is you have a system read Wikipedia. Maybe it's a robot that can interact with the world, and it induces these things. But nobody has been able to do this from the bottom up by just exposing their robots. I think I took this slide out. I'll take your question in a second. There's a field called developmental robotics, and they take basically what they do is they take the cutest robots they can find, the best thing from Sony this year. And they do things like they say to the robots, look at the ball, or let's say the bottle,
and the bottle goes back and forth, and the robot tracks it, and that's fine. They kind of model what my son was doing at 8 months. I was going to look at the bottle, and he was looking at the bottle, and now I have a daughter, and she's 8 months, and she's doing that, right? But somehow, in the last 14 months, my son has done something that none of these robots has been able to do. He learned syntax, he learned to put different words together into complicated sentences. He's learned to put sentences together into sequences of sentences that are connected with things like pronouns. And there's no system that can match that. None of these developmental robotic systems, all of which have a property in common that I'll say in a minute, have ever gotten anything like that. So nobody has built a developmental robotic system that gets to building complicated sentences. And like my son does a lot of kind of, I'll call it play-by-play of the world, which I was doing to him. In part to tutor us, so I was saying, you know, look, Alexander is lifting or Papa is putting on his hat. Or, now Alexander, my son, does all this kind of, he's describing the world around him. Nobody's gotten a robot to do that. Now, I think the problem is not that you couldn't build a robot in principle to do that. I mean, I think the brain is a kind of a computer. We can argue about, like, number of CPU cycles and all this kind of stuff, but I don't think that there's a physical limitation on doing this. Maybe there is with today's hardware, but even if you open it up and say you can use the whole resources of Google, you know, Google won't even tell you how many machines they have, but you know, safe to say it's a lot, right? So you can put the full resources of Google, which they did, or a lot of resources for the cat detector, on one of these machines, it never gets anywhere. I think the problem is that people are starting these machines with zero, and evolution did not start you with zero. It didn't even start a bacterium with zero. So bacterium has like minimally 500-600 genes that have been shaped over a very long time to give it very specific programs. Your brain is the product of, you know, several billion years of evolution going, you know, through multicellular organisms and up to mammals and primates, and there's a little bit of special sauce in the human brain that nobody quite understands. But that special sauce is there, and that's what allows you to take the input from the world and actually do something with it. So the difference between you and Google Translate is all it does is count the input. And you, your brain, says, what are the generalizations here? What, you know, what should I do with this data? Oh, I promised a question here.
Yeah, it's kind of a question slash comment, because basically you keep talking about it as though it's a question of insufficient amount of information or even a virtual language, but I don't know if you're maybe thinking about embodied knowledge or, you know, looking at this picture, a person would be able to tell if this is a man, not only because he has short hair, not only because of the way he's dressed. Maybe a French waiter, or maybe it's a context that's funny. Maybe
I'm willing to give a free pass on the stuff about him being French and what his outfit is and stuff. I'm really, for this purpose, interested in the physics, and I won't give a free pass to AI on the embodiment part. So it's a good question. Embodiment is like, we all have physical bodies, and some of our knowledge comes from those bodies. I think people exaggerate the extent to it. That's true. You can look at cases like people with spinal motor atrophy, SMA, and they still learn an awful lot about the world, even though they've never been able to move around. But even leaving that aside, the reason I'm not willing to give a pass is that the whole point of the developmental robotic stuff is they put their AI systems in robots with sensors that can move around, and essentially they have bodies, and that doesn't solve the problem. So my argument is we have essentially unlimited data now. We have systems with really cool sensors in it. I mean, we live in, you know, the wearable era where you put any sensor you want in a robot, any sensor anybody can imagine, doing all kinds of things nobody ever even imagined a couple of years ago. We have the, you know, the clusters of Google that we can throw at these problems. And still people have made no real progress at making AI systems that are flexible in their understanding of the world. So in motor control, they've made some. So Big Dog and its brethren are able to go over uneven ground and stuff like that. But even there, they're no match for my son, who can like look at a, you know, a couch with some pillows in some kind of funny way and figure out how to climb up it.
And it's also having the ability to judge the situation as a kind of social awareness, not simply.
Well, this is true too, but I'm saying even if you factor out all that stuff, and you can look at an autistic child who doesn't have much social awareness, that most of them will still get motor control that exceeds what the robots get, and certainly get intuitive physics understandings that the robots don't. So I think that stuff's actually really important. And probably most of you saw the movie Her. My critique of that movie, which I love, is that the one part that's most realistic is the degree of, sorry, most unrealistic, is the degree of social understanding that they program their machines in. I can actually imagine the machines developing the language that Scarlett Johansson's character develops. But the social understanding, we're a long way from doing. So I mean, I appreciate the point about social understanding. But I would say that the real problem is even when we have the embodied robots, we give them lots of data, we give them lots of CPU time, they still don't get there. And the reason is because they're not given strong enough starting points to be able to represent theories about the world and things like that. Instead, for sociological reasons, the people who build these robots are always what I would call an empiricist. They're always completely data-driven. And we're just not going to learn enough from bottom-up data alone. Another way I think about this as a cognitive scientist is, why do we learn language? Well, it's partly because we're exposed to language, but it's not just because we're exposed to language. You can expose, you know, Google to language, and you can expose a chimpanzee to language. There, somebody actually raised chimpanzees among humans. The chimp was named Nim Chimpsky. You can look it up. There's some controversies around it, but the bottom line is that Nim did not learn language despite the exposure. So the real question is, like, what are the core learning mechanisms inside us that allow us to transform the data? The data is a prerequisite. The computational power, I don't know. I mean, people argue about what the computational power of the human brain is. But when you think about how messy our neurons are and how slow they are, I'm not necessarily that impressed by our computational power. I don't think the answer lies there either. I think it lies in terms of the circuitry. I see two questions, and I think I can take both, and then I'll move on.
I just think it's also worth noting that the robots I've seen, like Big Dog, can handle problems that are really dynamically complicated. Control issues,
yeah.
They're running control loops that are hundreds of times faster with much smaller delays than you can manage, with much, much more accurate sensors, like hundreds of orders of magnitude more accurate sensors.
Yeah,
without
they,
that, it doesn't work.
They can't, they wouldn't be able to work with the crude data that people get.
It's really not with this, the delays that people work with.
I think
it doesn't work if you have less than 1,000 hertz control.
I'm going to take this question. I know you have one, but I'm going to go on. I'll come back.
So, as we're discussing this idea of artificial intelligence, is it this ability to have abstracted data to a general level and build a theory that can then be applied to novel situations?
I think that's the most important thing, personally. I mean, I think there are two most important things. One is the ability to do that abstraction, and the other may be some starting points. So those of you who have read The Critique of Pure Reason, which is Immanuel Kant's great book that is written so badly that I'm told that German philosophers prefer to read it in English translation. It's a fabulous book that basically argues for nameness. At least this is how I would recast it. It says, look, you need things like time and space to be innate. If you have those, then you have a starting point. I think we have strong starting points, like notions of time and space and maybe physical object and entity, maybe noun and verb and subject and predicate. We may not have hundreds of these, but I bet we have dozens of them. And if you start with those, then you can learn things. Liz Felke had this, developmental psychologist at Harvard, had this nice line about how if you start with a notion of an object, you can learn about the objects in the world and how that unsupported objects fall and so forth. But if you don't even start with the notion of an object, which a lot of these developmental robotic systems don't, then what's going to tell you that there's objects in the world rather than just stuff? Like, how are you going to jump into the system? So I think it's partly that we're looking for generalizations, not just a bunch of factoids, the way ultimately I think the deep learning systems are. And part of it is that we're not starting from zero, that evolution over several billion years has given us a starting point so that when we come out of the womb, we have some idea of what we're looking for instead of zero. If anybody is really good on Apple and can tell me how to get this to stop looking for a server that I don't want to look for, make me happy. Mavericks has made me miserable. Talk to me afterwards. Here's another example. You don't see a car in this lake, I'm guessing. Even you, anybody in the front row see a car in the lake? Yeah. But one of the popular vision systems, not deep learning, but one of the popular systems sees a car in there and somebody did an analysis, and it's because, well, if you look at the feature detectors that it uses, it sort of looks like there's a car there. But you don't think there's a car in the lake because you know something about cars and lakes. I could persuade you that it might be a reasonable hypothesis there's a car in the lake. How would I persuade you? I'd say, well, we were watching The Sopranos and right. So you can imagine a scenario, but in ordinary circumstances, you don't. So another issue is these systems have no top-down knowledge. They don't know about the world. So they're trying to glean everything from the bottom-up signal, from the pixels, and not from the ambience.
Here's another example. No intelligent adult would have problems with this. Even in the back row, I think you can probably answer. Which one is closer to us, Paris or Saturn? Raise your hand if you think it's Saturn. I type this into a search engine and I find where I can get a Saturn car, Saturn wheels.
It's
Bing,
though.
Yeah, that was my equal opportunity moment. I was picking on Google. Or, you can try it with Google. Last I checked, even Wolfram couldn't get that. So here's another example. Where maybe if we understood how people work better, it would really help us with the AI, which are generics. They're sentences that are useful even if they're neither literally nor statistically true. So generics are sentences like triangles have three sides. Some of them are statistically 100% true. And then there are ones like dogs have four legs that are statistically true. So most dogs have four legs, but we've probably all seen the occasional three-legged dog. Cars have radios. This used to mostly be true, except in New York City, where they were always stolen. So the statistics varied with location. Then you have things like ducks lay eggs. Is that true of most ducks?
Half at best.
Half at best, right, is the correct answer, right? It's not true of pre-adolescent ducks. It's not true of, you know, post-menopausal ducks. It's not true of ill ducks. So, and none of the males, right? So it's true of, you know, whatever, 30%. Mosquitoes carry malaria. We can make sense of that. What percentage of mosquitoes actually carry malaria is like 2%. But we can reason from that, make inferences from that. I guess there I'm just explaining those data. But it turns out even kids can make sense of these things. No AI system knows what to do with these things. AI either traffics in the purely statistical or the purely logical. And somehow we're able to navigate those worlds in the way that AI systems haven't yet. So we can take something like ducks lay eggs and draw inferences, knowing that it's not 100% true, but draw reasonable inferences. Here, what I'm suggesting really is a research program. I'm saying that if people wanted to advance AI, they would study humans a bit more. These would be the kinds of cases where we might get some useful insight. If you don't mind, I just have a couple more slides and then I'll take general discussion. So, prognosis. The field of AI appears healthier than it actually is. There's so much enthusiasm about AI. There's also a lot of terror about AI that comes from the enthusiasm. And I don't think that people are wrong to worry about consequences of AI. We could talk about that. But I do think that when Elon Musk says, you know, we've unleashed, what did he say?
The demons.
You know, we haven't actually figured out how to make the demons yet. So we might someday, but right now we haven't. On the biggest questions in AI, which is how to reason flexibly about new things, we just haven't made that much progress. And statistics and big data, they're important, but they're never going to get us all the way there by themselves. I think the only route to true machine intelligence will begin with a better understanding of human intelligence. By the way, that's alluding to something I forgot to say, which is there's another possible route, which is to basically simulate every neuron in the brain. If you're interested in my take, I'd be happy to talk about it. I thought I had one more slide. I'll take questions. I took out the other
slide. I'd be interested in
this. All right, well, I'll do that now, and then I'll take more questions. So my take on that is that it's not going to happen anytime soon. In this new book that I have, The Future of the Brain, I wrote the epilogue with Christoph Koch, who's the chief science officer at the Allen Brain Institute and well-known for his work on consciousness and so forth. And we project neuroscience 50 years from now. We talk about the project in Europe right now to build a simulation of the human brain. And one thing we say in this sort of science fiction scenario is Moore's Law might run out. And if it does, we might have a real problem in building a simulation that runs in anything like real time. So we may eventually get to the point where we really can simulate a human brain. But first, we have to figure out what we're even simulating. What is the sampling unit that matters? Is it the neuron? Is it the circuit? What can we abstract away from? Nobody knows the answers to any of those questions. And then once we do, there may be so much computational complexity that we just can't run it in a reasonable amount of time. That we've really learned from neuroscience per se is small. I'm a big fan of neuroscience. I now have an appointment in the neuroscience department. I think about it a lot. I work on it a lot. But I don't think that neuroscience has given us a lot for AI. It could eventually. I think the short-term prognosis for that is small. Kurzweil actually rests part of his argument for why we might expect to get strong AI in the next 20 years on the neuroscience approach. He says, you know, we'll be able to scan the brain with nanobots or whatever he calls them, and then we'll be able to just build a simulation. And so far, that approach has not yielded a lot of fruit. The most impressive thing is
arguably, the cortical microcircuit that they've modeled in the European version of the Brain Initiative. But there's no grounding to indicate that they've got it right. So there are movies, look at all these neurons flashing and something's happening, but there's no tying that to any kind of behavioral measure or anything, really. So like, it's like, what happens if we put a lot of neurons together? We don't know if they're the right kind of neurons or anything like that.
So, so building off of that, do you think that there's like a route to strong AI through, you know, through not necessarily modeling every neuron in the brain or even every circuit in the brain, but trying to abstract general principles and network architecture in the brain?
Sure, absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, I think it hasn't worked a lot yet. I mean, I think the one idea that people have really gotten is the thing that's driving deep learning, this idea of hierarchical feature detection. I mean, people have gotten a lot of mileage out of that, so I don't want to say it's zero. But that's really the only idea that people have taken from neuroscience, and they don't take it that literally. There's this very nice interview with Jan LeCun, who's my colleague at NYU, but also the director of AI research at Facebook, in the IEEE Spectrum in the last couple of days. I think it came out yesterday. And he says, look, you know, people want to call my things convolutional neural networks. And I just call them convolutional networks because I know they're not really accurate models of the brain. I had a little private workshop with a bunch of leading neuroscientists, and Jan was there a couple of weeks ago, and he was like, you know, this is really interesting stuff we're doing, but I don't want to claim that this is actually what the brain does. Someone who hasn't asked the question yet.
So what do you think about projects like Open Cog, which are trying to model, like, a very, very simple brain, and modeling all aspects of that organism in terms of how it feeds, reproduces, moves, navigates?
You're talking about Open Worm?
Open Worm, yeah. So they're sea elegans. Simulation.
I often tweet about them. I love what they're doing because it's open source. I didn't like their Lego demo at all. They put their thing in a bunch of Lego, you know, techniques blocks or something like that. And that to me seemed like publicity stunt. We don't have any grounding again to know whether we're doing this right. Like, I think it's in a way premature. I think in principle what they're doing is the right thing, which is to have completely open source stuff and anybody can play with it at home. So I think we need to democratize neuroscience to make it work. And the Allen Brain Institute is also putting all their data online. So I like that. I don't think they've actually figured out how the worm's brain really works. I mean, people I know who follow that literature very closely aren't that impressed with the particular simulation results, which isn't to say they couldn't get a lot better.
So kind of going back to the idea of the amount of data and that we sort of have all the data we need right now, right? And I think that's one of the problems, right? We don't have, like, look at the ImageNet competition, right? They had to send a bunch of images. The reason why they only had so many categories is because they were paying people to actually hand code and categorize these images, right? So it seems like there is a problem not having either the right data or enough of that data, right? I mean, the language programs like Google, I mean, Peter Norvig said the unreasonable effectiveness of data or something along those lines, where, you know, you sort of hit these inflection points with data and it's like, okay, we have enough statistical representations here that we actually start making either some abstractions or at least.
Yeah, this is what I'm doubting. So I think that here's another way to frame my argument altogether. The systems that we're using are very data hungry. They need enormous amounts of data, and kids don't. So kids don't require the same magnitude of data in order to learn. So that tells me that the systems that we have are not as efficient. So we are currently using systems that need, you know, gigabytes of data to get anywhere. And kids in a year or two can get further than those systems. It's telling us that something that we're doing isn't right.
But I think if you even just look at the visual system, right, that's terabytes of data like every few minutes. Right, and so whenever you're trying to do any computer vision stuff, you've got to downsample things just so you can process it, right? So
if all you want is kind of raw visual stream, then you can get terabytes of data. I mean, people get these things, they just don't know what to do with them.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, some of the new stuff that they're doing with Leap Motion, right? They have a new demo where they're using binocular vision. Mm-hmm. And they're running up against just hardware limitations of USB 3. Right, they're needing to push more data through the system than they're able to do. Not to mention, just, you know, we're able to learn a lot about people through Facebook, but that's not a really detailed representation of someone, right? I know a lot more based on dealing with people, watching their facial reactions, and and a lot of those correlations, right? So I think we're missing a huge percentage of correlations. My personal feeling is that as these, say, driverless cars even get into the world, or robots get into the world, that they're going to have a whole host of experiences. I mean, my phone's out right now recording, but the rest of the time it's sitting dark in my pocket, right? It's not being exposed to things constantly and things like that, like we are.
I mean, I don't doubt either A, that we're going to get many orders of magnitude more data soon, or B, that in some domains having more data might help. But what I'm doubting is that relying purely on data-hungry solutions is really getting us to deep insight into how to build AI. Starting to lose my voice, so maybe three or four more questions.
Coming from the outside, I'm a little confused. How are any of these metrics of strong AI really fundamentally different than the Turing test?
Well, let's start with my comprehension challenge versus the Turing test. In the Turing test, what you have to do is, in 5 minutes, persuade a human being that you're a machine. And
three or five, or whatever it is.
Well, yeah, I mean, people play games with the rules. But what you can do is human asks a question, and you don't answer it if you don't know it. You evade the question. This is how it's actually gone. And so essentially, the human interlocutor gets no real information at all, because you know, and the winner is like, I'm Eugene, I'm from Odessa, and then you ask a question like, what's the weather like in Odessa? It doesn't know how to, and you might actually know that one, but it's slightly more sophisticated thing. Do you see any icicles in Odessa? And it'll say, I don't know, but where are you from? And there's no useful information that's gained from that exercise. As opposed to the comprehension challenge, where what we do is we put in a video of, I don't know, icicles forming in my Manhattan apartment, and then I say, what's going on? And you have to actually answer, and we compare you to humans that have answered. We get a database of the kinds of questions that humans can answer and not. And we find that humans can answer questions like, I see icicles, this is unusual because people don't usually have icicles in the apartment and so forth. And you see if the machine can do the same. And you know, you can bound it in different ways and so forth. But the idea is that instead of being an exercise in evasion, you're actually answering questions. There's many, many hands. I'll give you a quick follow-up and then I'll...
I guess what I meant was that in some sense, you know, you're just... seeing if the machine fools you into simulating human intelligence. I mean,
no. So look, let me say one more thing there, and then I'll take the next question. I don't really care per se about human intelligence as the ultimate measure. What I care about are machines that are flexible, that can do new things without being specifically programmed for all of them. And I'm looking for some working way of getting at that. I'm also interested, for example, in this idea of open-ended video game competitions. I don't tell you the game in advance. You've got to play it. Can you play it well? And I don't think, as I said before, that the human has to be the top of the, you know, the highest level. I mean, like in chess, we already know that machines can play better than people. So, and for that matter, in arithmetic, nobody bothers to run the test, but obviously machines are better. So humans are just, you know, a measuring point along the way. I expect that in a lot of things, eventually machines will do better. But I would like to know when we have machines that are smart enough to be able to read a text passage and actually be able to form representations so that they can answer questions about those things. Like that would be a real advance.
So you mentioned recurrent neural networks, and if I remember right, one of the initial criticisms of feed-forward neural networks was they didn't have variables, right?
That was my criticism.
Okay. Yeah. So mentioned in Montreal, so I'm guessing you were in NIPS, right?
Yeah, I was in NIPS.
They mentioned the neural Turing machine out there.
Yeah.
They seem to have the ability to store variables. I'm curious what
possibly. It's not clear what that paper does. It's a very interesting recent paper you can find on our archive. It's also by people at DeepMind. It's just not clear what that system really can do. The paper, which I've read fairly carefully, is pretty underspecified as to what they actually do. And the real question is, so the model can kind of move in a space of programs, let's say. But the question is, when is it going to get stuck? When can it do this systematically? And the only examples they give are a copy operation, which is still not as good as a copy operation in the computer. Two others, I'm blanking on right now, but they're pretty limited. So
copy, repeat, and copy. They were very limited examples.
And so the question is, like, how is that going to scale to anything? And I think the answer is unknown.
Sure, but so there was that. I guess, in the LSTM, the long short term. Right?
The LSTM is, in the sense of having an explicit memory, a step closer to having representation of variables. The same thing with the neural Turing machine. In the back.
What types of neurotechnologies, or I guess just general biosensors, do you think are going to provide the most meaningful data or information for actually taking these kind of, I guess, the mistakes that humans make, or the human aspects of the human
actually,
brain, and applying them to artificial?
I actually think we need to do more psychology, to be honest. So I mean, it depends if we're talking long-term or short-term. Like, in the long-term, what we need are neurotechnologies that will allow us to understand individual neurons and their interactions. And so techniques like optogenetics that allow us to control individual neurons are very promising. But in the short-term, we don't know what to do with that data. And so that's going to help us eventually, but I'm not sure it's going to help us tomorrow. So I think the most important thing on the neural side really is that control of the circuits, the very fine-grained control. So you can think about most of the stuff that's been in the media about neuroscience for the last 20 or 15 years has been brain imaging, where you're looking at a voxel that has 70,000 neurons in it. I don't think that's going to tell you anything about how the circuitry really works. You want to understand something that's closer to like the equivalent of the transistor level. And so you need neural techniques that are going to get you there. And there's a lot of movement in that direction in the last few years. I think what we're really missing there is any theory about how to put it all together. In the short term, I think we might actually learn a lot by doing good psychology work to try to understand how people do things like common sense reasoning with generics, and so forth. But one could do that. There's not a lot of funding to do it right now, but one could. And I think it might actually be pretty useful. And if you look at like how Watson works, and it's kind of impressive, there's a lot of things there that basically leverage how human beings do things. It comes from a psychological level. All right. Three short questions, and then it'll be the end.
Okay, quick sequence questions.
No, you get one. I'm going to come back to you when you're ready for your one question.
Do you believe that superintelligence is an existential threat to humanity?
Yes. I don't think it's an urgent, immediate threat, but I think we should have people worrying about it. So, I mean, here's my shortest version, since I'm getting tired, for why we should be worried about it, is all the smart people I know in AI agree with me that there's no chance in the next 5 years or 10 years of having a machine that's remotely as smart as a human being. You know, Elon Musk may think that, but nobody who's actually working in AI thinks that. Anybody who's actually working in AI realizes how hard it is, how limited their models are. Again, read this interview with Jan LeCun, who's Facebook AI director. He's totally honest. We've got a long way to go. So short term, no. But long term, I say, how are we going to stop this stuff from doing bad stuff to us in the long term? And nobody really has an answer to that. And that itself makes me worry. Right? You can think in certain directions, like program verification, but nobody knows how.